is the regular report that takes the management of perpetuals and corporate expenditures. We effectively set out when we reported in March the main projects and the improvement activities that were planned the year ahead. All the subsequent reports are really about how to take progress in relation to those. There are three items I particularly like to bring to your attention, two of which are connected with the recommendation at paragraph 13.2. On the first page, in paragraph 221, we talk about the renewal of property insurance. There was a substantial increase in this when we renewed the policy in June. We need to keep the property values in line because we don't have enough insurance. Do that by making sure that they're linked to an index that's produced by the Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors. In the past couple of years, that index has shown practically no increase or minimal increases because the economy, the national economy has been poor, construction costs have been suppressed because of that, and so building costs have been going up. With the national economy picking up, construction costs are starting to increase, and unfortunately, that would sort of feature in what we would have to pay to build one more school than one more centre during our own buildings. The good news is that those figures, the 10% increase, is still within the budget that we allowed for this policy, but our argument is to give us some context as to why that is an increase as a result. The second point I'd like to bring to you is on the following page at paragraph 227. A number of the contracts that we have, insurance contracts, have clauses that allow us to extend if that's what we're continuing to do. The civil litigation contract, which is basically a contract that covers the fees we pay to solicitors for legal services we have to defend the claims, that has a rate clause at the first of April next year. In the last couple of years, the legal landscape's changed completely. And terms on which that contract is based at, and no longer sustainable for the solicitor provider service. So that's what we would definitely be procuring for the full capacity process. I'd also like to talk to you very briefly also about the option to extend the casualty insurance, that's our liability insurance, of course, against liability insurance for employees. This too has an option to extend. In recent weeks, we've asked the holding insurers for what their terms would be for an extension. And of course, as we've said in the report, at the moment, they're expecting a substantial increase from us. We don't believe that's justified, and we are arguing with them. In a gentle way, that this should not apply, should we decide to extend the contract. The recommendation is that we're not in a position to conclude those negotiations, and we will have to conclude them before the next time this committee meets, because otherwise it'll be too late to hold a tender and decide we need to have a tender, so there are to make that decision will be deferred to the appropriate resources. And finally, the paragraph 229, as part of our ongoing where we're trying to save we've been looking at the liability claims line, which is currently administered by the insurers, special claims handlers. But we need to attach the decision, which we need to have a final say whether they're accepted or rejected. We think that we could do more of our administration in-house. We would get a saving from the insurers because they wouldn't be doing all the work anymore. It would mean perhaps modest improvement of one member of the team because they'll be taking on more responsibility than the legal technical requirements of them. But we think that would be quite a decent option for the legal authority. Again, that's still subject to final negotiations, so again, we're asking if you would be amenable to the final decision and take on the treasury. Because again, it's limited to the real liability insurance and the details if we need the decision to find themselves in the technical. So they would be the main points for Mr. Harley. I'm very happy to take any additional questions if you want. Is there scope in pooling our insurance, in pooling our negotiations with other local authorities? Given it seems there's such a small market there, is there an opportunity of doing that?
What we do at the moment is that when we let our insurance contracts, we actually do it on a private basis. So we go through the pooling process, or we let it on a private basis so that colleagues in other operators, for example, Liverpool or Ottawa are actually broken contracts and accept our difficulties and ensure that our liabilities are changing in the day. So we do look at that, and I'm hoping that we get slightly better deal with the insurance market, but that's a very, very unfortunate.
Could you put your microphone on, please, because we can't hear you back here. Obviously.
The quarter one review was primarily around the new risks that were coming out from directorate plans, because they just been formulated for 2015-15, which is being reported. So we wanted to see whether there were any cross-cutting risks, and anything that particularly wasn't in the corporate risk register at the time. We did know that there were some cross-cutting risks in the staff capacity, things like problems and service continuity, but all of those are already in the corporate risk register, and so there's no additional need to the targets on the register. And turning to the page, there was a further short review in August. The main points highlighted on that one was the risk of investigated on collaboration of funds and well-being, which was around the decision by the Supreme Court and the difficulties that that was causing for the directors. That one wasn't felt appropriate for including the corporate register at this time, but it's very much on the director of this register, and we monitored that to our team, and that if they can't, they would take that back to the chief executive strategy group of members. The appendix is not what you would have seen before. When I reported previously, I said what I would like to do in future is to give you more information, not just about the risk themselves, but about what we're doing to try and mitigate them and how well we're going with those. The appendix is quite a detailed document, and I would genuinely be interested in feedback as to whether you feel this is too much or whether you prefer more in the way of exception reporting. So I am sort of letting you know that projects that we're going to contract and we have managed to do on time, or whether you are happy to see the full information that basically we share with the corporate policy group and the chief technical strategy group. But I appreciate the quality document as it stands at the moment. So feedback would be very helpful.
Thanks, Chair. It is a weighty document, there's no doubt about that. But it is important. All this stuff is very, very important to this committee in particular. The appendix like this, I really welcome it. It is a lot to read. But the more information we've got, the better. We can't have too much information.
Thanks, Jim. It's nice to have very happy to continue to produce this in this form.
Yeah. Do you like the format of this? Similar to what Mark was each month.
Yeah.
Okay. Keep it going. Again, any questions tonight? Can we agree the recommendations then?
The report provides details of new revised HR policies, particularly about the role of the risk management committee, in particular our new dignity work policy procedure and supporting documentations. Details of changes about the previous policy procedure and details of the legal updates to the whistleblower policy. The report also sets out a communication training plan for the new and updated policies. We've outlined the background and some of the key issues. The HR policies for the council are subject to an ongoing review to ensure they remain fit for purpose, but also legally compliant and provide a valuable and workable document for employees and managers. We implemented across the council a new intranet site in January 2014, where many of the key document policy documents were refreshed and formatted. It also provided an opportunity for updates to rationalise the information that we had under the people section of the site. In terms of the prevalence for this particular committee, the annual governance statement in 2013-14 presented to the Audit Management Committee on 23rd of June 2014 and stated that progress had been made on further issues, and there were some outstanding issues that required some further work. That was particularly around embedding policies, particularly around confidential reporting and grievances. This report provides details of that work to ensure that the HR policies support the council's requirement for strong corporate governance and good people management. We have previously revised the whistleblowing policy in 2011 and the grievance policy in 2012, and a number of other policies have been agreed. The dignity of work policy, grievance and whistleblowing policies have clear links, which is why we brought them together in one suite for this particular committee and recommendation. The most significant amount of recent work has been undertaken around dignity of work procedure, which is a new policy, with some further revisions and updates which we made to grievance and whistleblowing. Paragraphs, the further report then details the summary of some of those changes, also details with the report the communications and training plan. This is particularly important in terms of the recommendations and requirement to embed the policies across the organisation. So it starts off with awareness raising through communication, further specific training on the suite of policies, and then ensuring that it's embedded into our central management training across the council. So if you have to take any questions on this, Chair.
In the development of both the grievance policy and the grievance policy, which was looking at that, can I ask what role the unions in developing that, please?
Specifically, on all of the policies, we have consulted with the trade unions on the policies. There are a number of policies. Policies are within the choice and decision making of the council, so we would consult them on good practice. We don't need their agreements in terms of the board, but we have one with one. There is a trade union issue that we have that is still ongoing in that we changed the appeals process from member to officer appeals. So on that basis, they're not in agreement with the policy, but we have worked with them on the policy and discussed with them.
What's the nature of the disagreement on that? What was reading about that? You said that it's currently at the stage of management.
The basis of the concern is a legacy concern, where we made a change to move from an elected member of the appeal process to an officer of the appeal process. concern is when we originally updated the policy on the last occasion, we updated in 2012. We took a decision, a decision was taken, a recommendation through to council.
Whistleblower monitor, which